Yes, please.
Welcome all of you for today's morning session. Before starting the session, I would like to give a brief introduction about today's speakers. And today, we have two speakers, Bosco Sebastian as well as Maya Bhatnagar. Bosco Sebastian is working in cybersecurity industry for about 6 years after completing MTech in cybersecurity. He is currently working as a security researcher with Microsoft. He works with vulnerability research, export analysis, malware analysis, and figuring out ways to protect from latest threats. Another speaker, a brief introduction, Maya Bhatnagar started his career in security research in around 2001 in the Government of India lab that known as the National Center for Software Technology, NCST. Now, see that. His work has mainly focused around researching and developing a state of security research product, carrying out protocol security, modeling and analysis, analyzing a vulnerability and malware, and for the sea. Currently, he is working in Netflix as a security researcher and based out of a banner. With a small and brief introduction, I welcome both the speakers and I request both the speakers to start the session. First, you can start the session.
Okay, thank you, Jada sir. This is Bosco. Am I audible properly?
I hope everyone are really hearing your voice.
Yeah, Bosco, you're audible.
Okay, thank you. So I request all of those people who are not speaking to mute the phone because it will be a disturbance to all others. Okay, I'm sharing my screen now. Can you guys see my screen?
Yeah, Vasco, we can see.
Okay, guys, good morning to all. I'm Bosco Sebastian. I work in McAfee as a security researcher. I have with me is Mike Bhatnagar. He's a lead security researcher at McAfee. Today, we are going to cover reversing binaries using debuggers and disassemblers. This would be an introductory tutorial. Is somebody requesting something? Do I need to approve or decline this? Okay. We'll be talking about reversing binaries here. This is actually a vast course. But we are squeezing it into a 1.5 hour session. So we'll be doing the introductory part only. From there, you can kickstart using the resources that are available in the internet. I'll guide you through some of the resources. Today's session will be covering stuffs like introduction to reversing and the applications of reversing and the requirements that somebody needs to start up a reverse engineering skills. And then, in order to understand the reversing process, you need to first understand how a source is converted into binary. Once you have the binary, how to reverse the process, how the reversing process works. So there are two phases inside. One is static analysis and dynamic analysis. In static analysis, we'll get to see the static code, and then we'll read through the code, and then we'll try to understand what is the logic of the program. The other one is the dynamic analysis, wherein we use debuggers to run the program inside the memory, and then see the contents of the memory, see the data, see the code running, and then we try to figure out what exactly the code is trying to do. So this is how our session will go. So I'm trying to give some demos today, and if you guys are interested, you can download these resources from internet so that you can have practical sessions if you are interested. It is not necessary, but it is always good to do some hands-on sessions so that you will get more doubts and you can clear once and while we go. The first executable is compiled by myself, and I have uploaded it to the GitHub repository. And the tool's PEView is a P parser. which can be used to download, which can be used to view a PE executable binary format. IDF Freeware is again a disassembler. We can use it for disassembling a process, a program or an executable. And WinDBG is the debugger that I'm using today. Sorry guys, I'm using only Windows tools today. If there are somebody who is using Linux, excuse me. And there are, if somebody can confirm what is this request all about, I can. So this is coming for the second time. Should I approve it or decline it?
No, don't approve anything. What requests are you getting this?
Somebody is sending an annotation request by Shalini MP. I'll decline it.
No, decline. Don't play request participant. Please don't try to disrupt the session.
Okay. So so I'll send the links in the chat. Since I'm using only one screen here at home, so I'll switch between screens. So you may get some disturbance. Sorry for that. But I'll send everything through WebEx chat so that you can download. Okay, from now on, Mike will take on from here for some slides. He is a lead security researcher at McAfee. So over to you, Mike. Mike, you can introduce yourself first and then.
Thank you, Bosco. Thank you, Professor Jaidhar, for coordinating this session with us. And it's a good opportunity for us to interact with all of you. So we welcome you all to the session. I'm Mayank Bhatnagar. I also work along with Bosco in McAfee as security researcher. And so this session is, as Bosco mentioned, is an introduction to reversing of binaries. Now let's say that if you receive this message file, it's just an introduction for me to begin with. Let's say if you're having this message file, then what kind of messages do you interpret from here? You can maybe write on the chat. Okay, so it's a welcome to session on reversing of binaries. If you see on the right side of the hex part, it's actually an ASCII, which is actually a message which says welcome to session on reversing of binaries. Right. So we have welcomed you all for this reversing introductory tutorial, and we hope this you will find it useful. Next slide, please. So what is actually reverse engineering? Now let's understand from this diagram. For example, this is one of our iron box, and if you are not having any specification, any design material available with you, you have just have a physical product with you. You want to come out with complete specification, and you want to make a complete product with you. So you start with obtaining of dimension details. You want to scan. You want to have an optical and manual measurement of the product, and you want to create a 3D model out of it. These are the different steps industries. Then you want to inspect the model, you want to compare the model with actual drawing, you come out with the drawing and specification yourself. And then finally, you actually give it for manufacturing. There are various instances in which this kind of reverse engineering has been used, is being used. So it's not a question of reverse engineering only in software. We do reverse engineering for various purposes. So what is actually reversing? I think you must be having all kinds of questions in your mind. What is actually reversing? When we are not able to have any kind of material available which can tell us about the product, its design, its architecture, or maybe in terms of software, its code is not available. We want to extract knowledge from the object directly from its availability without any aid of drawings or documentations. We want to reverse engineer the product. And basically, it's a man-made product. Similar things when it goes from a nature or scientific research community, it is called a discovery of whatever knowledge we want to gain from nature or science, scientific material. But here we are speaking about man-made industrial objects, software, or any other mechanical output. Let's go to the next slide, please. So why do we need to reverse engineer product? Often there are various requirements when we need to reverse engineer. We would have heard about original equipment manufacturers. Let's say OEM are manufacturing a design or product and they do not want to share their designs. They do not have, or they've stopped the production. They don't have any other warranty left, or they don't want to provide they don't have documentation, but they still want to continue in particular zone, in particular country. Or maybe the original manufacturer itself has stopped manufacturing. They don't no longer exist, but the customers still need the product. Customers still need some changes in the product. In that case, based on some discussions between OEM vendor or basically industry vendors or industry connects, people may start doing a reversing of the design. They want to come up with a new feature. They want to phase out bad features, or they want to develop better products legally. What do we mean by legally? We have a slide to discuss about the legal aspect of reverse engineering. So basically, we want to take permission, authorized permission from original manufacturer that we want to understand and we want to reverse engineer a product for a better purpose. And of course, there are bad purposes, unethical purposes also about reverse engineering, which again, the industry has have people to identify, okay, someone has reverse engineered a product, so we need to be cautious about it. We also need to reduce expenses. We also need to take care of the obsolete materials available with us. And so we want to move away with the obsolete materials. So there are various requirements of a reverse engineering of a product from generic perspective. Now let's discuss about why do we want to reverse engineer a software product. So when we say software, we have a complete software product that is functioning in the field. We might not be having a code for it. So we need to understand how it is functioning, what are its design, what are the various modules of the software involved. And it generally involves decompiling that complete binary code into something which is human readable or into some form of programming language, higher level programming language or broken programming language. So a developer or researcher can understand and understand its code behavior. Now there are various purposes of why we need to reverse engineer a particular software code, which we'll discuss it in more detail. But sometimes we don't have availability of particular good material to understand what is, or maybe the software source code authors do not want to reveal the source code, but they want people to actually analyze the code, or maybe they want people to play with the software. There could be various intentions. There are a few examples which I mentioned out here, like for example, how it all started and various good purposes wherein reverse engineering have been put into purpose. Now earlier, non-IBM implementation was not at all available for PCs and hardware and all. So PC buyers came up and they started manufacturing non-IBM architecture-based machines. Similarly, if you would heard about Samba software, so Windows, they did not publish their file sharing and other information. So still Samba came up and they started emulating Windows. And again, I'll give an example of Windows Scope, which is again a live memory reverse engineering of all running processes. Then you can have Bally Laboratories, which they started manufacturing their own Mac OS based emulation into their own RISC process architecture. So there are various examples in which people have gone ahead to reverse engineer the software and made it available for their own requirements, for their own architecture in terms of software. So we need such good engineers, good researchers, and requirement to carry out reversing of a software. Next slide, please, Bosco. Where all reversing a software is being used, so it's a prominent place where we want to find a security flaws in software. Now we are discussing a security session. Let's say we want to find a security flaw in software. What could be an issue? Why there could be, whether we really have shipped a product which is not having any vulnerabilities. Now let's give it to a team which can actually find out security flaws without any code inspection. So that could be a self-testing or self-security mechanism to enhance the security of the software. You also want to develop emulators which can work on different architectures seamlessly. We would have heard about Wine, you would have heard about like Samba is also a simulator, emulator, which can actually emulate your Windows native environment. You also want to passively analyze protocols, and you want to study the communication aspect of different maybe industrial machines, what they are interacting, and want to understand what kind of communication they are bearing. So that someone actually can someone actually trap your communications? All those things you want to study. Then malware and viruses. Often there are malware and viruses written with different kind of techniques, but we don't have the source code for it. So there are different techniques and methodologies used, which we want to find out what kind of technique they're using to spread out, what kind of technique they're using to actually download some malicious binary. So we don't have its particular code. We want to reverse engineer it. We want to understand the whole concept behind it. And that's how we develop antivirus mechanism or anti-malware mechanism to stop its flow. So there are various advancements in development of antivirus and anti-malware happening. Now these advancements are shaped by both the advancement in the hacking industry or the malware industry, plus the advancements to come out on top of that to provide better protection mechanisms, add new features used by hackers. Then there are also intelligence and espionage activities going on. So we need to have capability to understand what kind of espionage activity, software-based cyber espionage activities that are happening. We want to develop our own intelligence behind that activities. So we need to have better capabilities to carry out reverse engineering of a software product, which we have to understand out of it. Does it sound legal enough? Do you feel that is it legal? How much it is allowed, how much it is not allowed, it's all vague. We have different mechanisms wherein we can be caught, or any person who is doing it illegally can be caught or can be sued in the court. So there are various kind of entities in the law, various kind of framework in the law, which provides you means of which carrying out legally. So you need not actually, you should have a consent of the original developer, or basically the original developer allows, okay, you can do a reverse engineering in certain provisions of the software. You need to completely understand the end user license agreement, what it allows, what it does not allow, and how much aspect of software you can actually do a reverse engineering of the product. Either you are, whether you are using it for commercial purpose or not is also a matter of importance. Let's say if you want to reverse engineer, you want to understand the basic functionality for education purposes. That may be allowed. But now you're going ahead and actually making your own software out of it and selling it out into a separate world. So that may be actually illegal. You can also be violating your IPR rights attached with the software, patent, right? So all those things come into picture. Now various US laws have actually come out, and they have maintained a section for various provisions of fair usage of the software. For example, copyright and fair usage law of US law, it says that intellectual property is attached to the company that has created the software. So if you are reverse engineering, you are violating that IPR provision of it. Then there is a Digital Millennium Copyright Act. It says about technological protection measures. You cannot actually reverse engineer to break down the software. Then there's an Electronic Communication Privacy Act. Basically, it applies more from the military point of view or defense perspective point of view. You are trying to intercept the communications of the network entity, whatever kind of protocol they're communicating. So you have to be very careful what you're trying to do, what provisions of law you are actually harnessing when you're trying to do a reversing. Do you have communication with a vendor? Do you have a communication with the original equipment manufacturer? What you are allowed to do legally, a reversing of the software or not. There are various legal and ethical concerns. Indian IT Act 2000 also has written a separate passage, Section 52, and other cases where they are mentioning about reverse engineering of the software and the Copyright Act. And they are also allowed certain provisions which have been allowed in certain measures. So I've provided a link which you can actually refer and understand what are the different technicalities of reversing of software. So at this moment, it's just an introduction about what is exactly about reversing and how you need to be careful about reversing. We'd just like to take a pause out here, and if you have any questions, we can actually answer right now. And later on, Bosco can speak more about the technical aspect of it.
Sir, whether it will be covered under digital design aspects, you mentioned only the copyright.
Exactly. Design and IPR, patent towards design also are part of it.
Okay.
Not mentioning, these are different apps they have mentioned. There's no provision based on their focus point of view. But when you speak about design, you speak about actual the IPR perspective. So design also can be reverse engineered.
Okay. Okay. And parallelly, you have a separate this one division for PCBs inside Patent Act. I think so. That that also it will cover here, or it won't cover
only. No. This session is not covering about the. I have given. Okay. You have just provided links to it, so you can actually refer different acts. And okay. it's like an opening up. It's like an introduction session for you to actually widen your scope to read more aspects of it.
Okay. Understood.
Okay. Any other question? Okay. Thanks. We would like you to be interactive so that we all know where you are, what kind of questions you're having, what kind of thoughts you're having. And maybe from now onwards, Bosco can take it up.
Okay. Thank you, Mayankji. Okay, so we'll now do more technical concepts of reversing binaries. I would like to have a fair, you know, how many of you have done reversing or have used debugging or disassembling tools? Maybe you can put it in the chats and mine can reply back to me. Because I have been informed that, you know, you people are like undergraduate and PhD students. So how many of you have tried your hands-on reversing, at least use the any disassembler or debuggers? Okay. I could see a few response in my screen also.
Yeah.
So, okay, good. So many people have. It is actually very good, you know. When I was at my undergraduate, I never knew about all these things. Once I moved into MTech in cybersecurity, I learned about all these things. But still, you know, it's very good that, you know, people are getting experience in IDEA and other reversing tools at the undergraduate level. So I need to emphasize also that, you know, once cybersecurity is talked about among freshers, most of the people are into web app pen testing, which is good, but we need more people in malware analysis, vulnerability research, and all. For that, we need more people who have the skills of like reversing and, you know, understanding things. So actually, so let this session be a kickstart for those people who are like, who wants to have their career in reverse engineering. So with that, my first slide here. So if you see the diagram in the slide here, so an executable code, if you open it up in some Explorer or something, it would be mostly binaries, zeros and one. So you won't get anything by looking at a particular executable. So you need to have some strategies, some tools to reverse engineer and try to understand what exactly this executable is doing. So as Mayank has already mentioned, you know, reverse engineering comes in many areas in computer security, for example, for vulnerability research. There are some companies who open up their softwares and ask security researchers out there to do analysis on their system and then to report the vulnerabilities back. So either they'll be acknowledged or they'll be paid heavily. I'll be talking about it more in the last slides. And also other applications that Mayank has already touched upon. So in order to become a reverse engineer, first of all, you need to know the system first. So the basic things that you need to know are, first of all, the computer architecture. You need to have a little bit knowledge of how the computer works. And then a low-level language such as assembly language, because assembly language is like is lying most close to the machine, and machine understand which is like binaries, and then assembly language is a textual format of that binaries. And C and C++, because though in high-level language these C and C++ like languages are like more close to machines rather than other managed codes. Also, you need to have understanding of X number system and binary number system, because everything in computer's language would be in binary format, and it is easier for us to understand hex format, so we convert directly to hex hex digits. So there is like a transformation between binary and hex while you reverse engineer or something, and decimal comes once in a while here and there, so it is always better to have some understanding of hex numbers. And important of all, you should have the curiosity to know what is actually happening inside the binary, so that and your curiosity never dies. You know, you may fail 100 times and then you will succeed one time, but you have to go through all those fails to succeed finally. So let me go through basics first. So regarding computer architecture, there are like three main things that we have to worry about while reverse engineer a binary, because that is where the binary resides. Okay. The first one is the CPU, the memory, and the hard disk. Because when you are saving a binary in your system, it is actually residing in your hard disk. And when you want to execute it, the binary is loaded, is moved into the memory. The memory I'm talking here is the RAM. So whenever I'm referring memory, it is RAM that I'm talking about. So the executable will be moved into the memory, and the CPU can now take upon the code that we have written from the memory and then start executing it. Also, we need to know about registers, which is like again a memory session, which is actually residing inside the CPU itself. And based on your computer architecture, it can be 32-bit and 64-bit in size, because 32-bit means which is 4 bytes in size, and 64-bit means 16 bytes in size. So why registers is needed? Because in order to get something out of the memory, it would take some time. But if you have to have, for example, if you need to have something which is like frequently required by the CPU, which will be stored in the register, so that the operations by the CPU would be much faster. And there are some special. So if we are talking about registers, there are like different types of registers. EAX, EBX, ACX, and EDX are all general purpose registers. These registers can be used for used by the CPU for any purpose, for storing data, for doing operations on it. But there are some special registers called index registers and pointers. We need to know about these registers, because when we are debugging things, we need to track the contents of these registers. For example, there is something called EIP, which is a register which points to the instruction that the CPU is going to execute. It keeps track of the flow of the program. And there is something called EBP and ESP. So everything in the when a program starts, so the operating system creates a space in the memory called a stack. So this stack keep tracks of the functions inside the memory. It keep tracks of the function code, which we'll discuss later in the tutorial. And also there is something called ESI and EDI. This can be used as general purpose, and also it can be used as a special index registers, because if you are doing a memcopy or a string str copy function, ESI and EDI will point to the destination where the data has to be copied, and ESI will be pointing towards the memory location where the data is kept. So these are some special registers. And also we have flags and status registers. Flags will keep the status. For example, if an operation by the CPU result in zero, there is a zero flag inside the CPU, which will be set so that the computer knows that, okay, the last operation has resulted in a zero. And based on that, the next operation will be decided. For example, jump statement. While we debug, we'll get to know this. And also there is something called paging, which is exactly worst topic, which is required, but I'm going to talk very less about it, because in a 4GB memory, everything will be stored. In a 32-bit system, 4GB of memory space is available, but your RAM may be small, or many process would be running, so enough RAM is not available. So what happens, you know, everything loaded into the memory cannot reside in the RAM. So what they'll do, they'll keep some things inside the hard disk, and whenever required, it will be brought back to the memory. That is called paging. And operating system course, you might have already studied it. And there are good resources out in the public if you want to do some practicals. You can. So that is about computer architecture. Now we move into assembly language. So assembly language is the lowest level in the software developing. So what happens is, like, when you are compiling a program, it will be building a program, it will be moved in where it will be converted into a binary, which represent some particular instruction. For example, if you can see here, 89EF is a binary, a hex number, which represent move EBP ESP. So for the machine, it understand for example, this 89EF is a it can be only understood by the machine. But if you want to understand, you have to first disassemble. It means you need to get that textual representation of this 89EF. So which is move EBP and ESP, and this is architecture specific for Intel architecture, Intel x86 architecture. 89EF is move EBP ESP, and for some other architecture it would be different. So it is platform specific, and assembler converts your assembly language into opcodes. The opcodes is the binary that thing that I'm talking about. And disassembler converts the binary machine code into textual commands so that we can understand it. So we need to understand stack thoroughly if you need to reverse engineer any program inside a memory. So stack is actually a conceptual area in the main memory, which is designated by the OS when a program starts. Why it is needed? It is used for passing arguments to the function that it called. It is used for storing the return address once the function that we called has done its functionality and it has to return back to the call function. You need to store the return address. And then it needs to store the as I told, EBP and ESP are two registers which keeps track of the stack. EBP always going towards the base of the stack. So for a function, there is a stack frame for a function. So EBP will always point towards the base of the stack, and ESP will point towards the top of the stack. So whenever a main function calls another function, a new stack frame is formed, and the base pointer for the main function will be stored, and EBP will be populated with a new stack frame, a new pointer which points toward the base of the new stack frame that it created. So you will get more understanding once we go through the debugging session. So you can see the memory, how actually it works, so that you will have the real understanding. So you need to know that ESP will always point towards the top of the stack, and EBP will point towards the base of the stack. Base in here is actually a relative term. Base, it depends upon the order that has written, how a stack frame is defined. For example, for here in this diagram, the stack frame contains the function argument, the return address, the base pointer of the previous stack frame, and the local variables that the function that it needs. So a stack frame can be this, or the stack frame can start from here. So it depends upon the order. You have any doubts? Okay. So you need to know some of the few basic assembly instructions so that you can go forward. One is like push stack, as you may be already knowing it, but for the sake of understanding it again, there is something called a push statement. Push statement, what it does is, like, it will take data and then it will push it into the stack. Also, I need to remind you guys about one thing. The stack will always grow to a lower address. So, for example, if the memory starts from 0x000 to 0xFFF, the stack will always move towards 0x000. That is how conventionally stack grows. So that is this procedure has been followed by almost all compilers that I know. I don't know if any other compilers does the other way. So if you are pushing something onto the stack. So for example, here if you see, there is push EAX. And EAX contain a value 0x003, and if you're pushing it into the stack, so what happens? the ESP is pointing towards the top of the stack. As you can see, the memory is decreasing as the stack grows, and the stack grows in the bottom direction. So if you are pushing, some data, for example, before push, the stack would look like this, and the, after the push, the value of EAX has been moved to the stack, and the ESP has been decremented by 4. That you need to focus here, because as I told you, the stack always grows towards the lower address. Subtracting ESP will actually makes the stack grow. So here it has been subtracted by 4 because I am concentrating on a 32-bit system. So always when a stack operation happens, it always happens in 4 byte at a time. So here, this is how push operation happens. A pop operation, how it happens, if you need to take something out of the stack. So it always, as you all know, stack, it is always first in, first out. So it will, the operation will always happens at the top of the stack. So if you see here, it is a pop EAX operation. And before, the ESP is pointing towards the memory location which contains 03 as the data. And when you are doing a pop operation, what happens, it is pop EAX, the data in, which is pointed by the ESP will be copied into EAX, and ESP will be added by 4 bytes. So here it was 88, when it is added, it will become 86. So that is how pop operation happens. And there is something called call operation, call instruction. What happens when you want to call another function? For say, for example, I want to call a function B from function A. So what happens if you are doing a call operation, the control will be transferred from A to B. That means the EIP will be pointing towards, EIP was pointing towards some instruction in A. When you execute call operation, EIP, the register which points to the instructions, EIP will now point towards the first instruction of function B. And it also does one more thing. What it will do is like it will store. So if function A is calling function B, if function the CPU will store the next instruction, the address of the next instruction after the call statement of function A to the stack, so that after the function B executes and completes its functionality, it can come back to function A. So that is how call operation works. Returns means after the function B has completed its operation, it needs to come back to function A. So a return statement is executed. That does mean that it will come back to the call function. Now there is a move and other instructions. We will learn some of the instructions as we go through this assembly and debugging. But we need to take care of all these instructions. Okay, so this is how a high-level language would look like. If you want to execute something like this, you can do A multiplied B, add 10. So in assembly language, it would move, it would look like something. This move EAX A. So in Intel syntax, the destination place would be always the first one, and the second will be the source operand. So for example, move EAX A will move whatever is in A to EAX, and multiplied B. So it has to be taken into account that, you know, whenever there is a single operand instruction, so the second operand will be always existing in EAX. So here what it is doing is like, if we have transferred the content of A into EAX, now multiply B means it will multiply the content of B with EAX, and the result will be stored in EAX. Now again, the next instruction add 10, so it will add 10 to EAX, and then finally what will we do is like the result has to be stored in a location D. So move EAX D will convert whatever is in EAX to D. So this is the assembly language look like. Once you use the assembler to get the opcodes, it would look like something like this. So which is like not understandable for us, but you need a disassembler to see how it looks like. Okay, so last thing that you need to learn in the basics is like the format of an executable. So when you compile some source code, you will get an executable. For a Linux system, you'll get a ELF. For Windows system, you'll get portable executable. So portable executable is a generic term that is used for like anything executable in the Windows. It can be exe, it can be dll, or anything that is executable. So so this is how the p executable looks like. So if you have downloaded the things that I have already told you to, you might have PE view with you. If you have not downloaded it, it's okay. Don't you know, go after it so much. You better listen to the tutorial so that you'll understand it. So you have something called PE view. There are other better PE parsers, better parsers like CFF Explorer and everything. But PE view will give us more understanding about the PE executable format. So let me open PE view here. And then once you open the PU, it will ask which exe it needs to pass. So let me open. So the gatekeeper exe, again, it's a compiled exe by me, but gatekeeper exe is actually a CTF binary. CTF, some of you may be knowing, it is capture the flag computation that happens. So what you have to do is that you need to try to figure out what this exe does. And then you have to find out, maybe actually this gatekeeper.exe, you need to find out what is the username and password for this gatekeeper.exe. So I have downloaded the source code and then I have compiled it for our use. So here you open gatekeeper.exe, and this is how a exe would look like. So it is, as I told you, this is again binaries, and you won't understand anything. But if you're using a PE parser, so it will parse and then it will show you what all are this information. For example, first 2 bytes are MZ, which is 4D byte pair. So what does that mean? So if you are clicking image dos header, it will parse it and it will show. It says that it is a signature file. So all the PE executable in Windows will start with MZ, which is MZ, which is 5A440. I could see some questions coming up, but I don't know. So
can continue. Maybe if you can pause for a moment, and anyone wants to ask, but I am answering those questions on the chat.
Okay. I'll pause after this PE executable format.
Sure,
and
sure, sure. Yeah, sure.
So the image header would look like the PE executable header would look like this. First, it would contain a DOS header. So DOS header actually is not required for the PE executable, but it is kept there because before Windows, it was a DOS operating system, and DOS operating system used these headers. And for backward compatibility, they have kept these headers with it. So only thing that you need to know about here is like the first 2 bytes would be MC, and there will be a pointer to the next header, which is. Let me see what it is. I think this is where next header starts. So it will always go towards where the next header starts. So it says it starts at the offset 40. So if you go to offset 40 here, no, offset to the new exe header is at 80. So it says where the next offset header, new exe header starts. So it is at the offset 80. So if you go to NT headers, you can see that it starts at 80. And then let's see what is inside the NT header. So it always starts with a signature signature bytes PE, which is 4550. And then here there are like some consequent bytes. So here it talks about the mission that it has. It is compiled for. It is compiled for a x86 system, and the timestamp which it is compiled, and some of the characteristics of this executable. So this is an executable. It's reloads ASCII script. It's for 32-bit system. So you don't. This is how the header looks like. And there is something called an optional header, which is not optional at all. I don't know why they have kept the name optional. And here it refers other. It contains the pointers and the size information of all other the next part of the binary executable. So, for example, here there are different sections in a binary executable: dot text section, dot data section, dot add data section. So so if you go here, the parser will parser can get information, or the operating system will get information about the sections here. So let me talk about sections a little bit more. Here, if you see text section, so text section contains again this naming of the section is a convention that we follow. It doesn't have to be always dot txt section, but it is the convention that for or any other compilers follow. So dot text section mostly contains the code of the program. So it contains the instruction, binary instructions, and this is where the binary instruction is stored. Dot data contains the data that that needed by the program to run, and R data or read only data contains the information that can be only read and cannot be moved. IData contains the import table, which means sometimes this executable doesn't have the all functionality. For example, print function. You know, this executable, when I wrote a program, I don't want to write a function for print, but rather I want to use a print library, a print function, which is provided by another library. So, you know, when you are running that executable, the function will be imported from another library. So all the import data will be kept inside IData. And such like TLS data is again a thread local storage, which is again empty here, and we don't have to give much importance to it. So that is how a P executable looks like. And so I'll give you a rather good tutorial to learning about P executable, a life of binaries. If you are doing reverse engineering or taking up reverse engineering seriously, you need to go through this tutorial. I'll give you the link in a while. So that is it about the basics of binary. Do you have any questions till now, or shall I proceed?
Yeah, Bosco, I think there was a question about a very equivalent tool of PView on Linux. I think we have several tools which are not so much well built into Linux, but maybe you have any answer.
Even I have not I used much this thing in Linux, but I think object dump is a tool that can be used in Linux for seeing a ELF format.
ELF
object. Yeah, right. So object can dump can be used, but otherwise, yeah, simple search in internet would give you tools. There would be a number of tools in the Linux for doing that.
So you can also, Gautam, so you can also use libelf. It's not programmatic if you want to do, but
yeah,
the tools are not well much organized like PView. You
know, the thing is that if you are using Linux, it is like much command oriented, and then object dump is one such tool that you can use, it seems. I don't know any graphic. I've never used any graphic user interface tools in Linux. But sorry about that. But I think, you know, if you're opening an ELF inside Windows, you can probably use some CF Explorer or something. But I'm sorry about that. I can get back to you on this.
Yeah, we'll get back. Correct.
Yeah. So if that it is all about, I will dive into the disassembly and debugging. So here, so before moving into disassembly and debugging, so this is how the building process happens. So whenever you are writing a source code, it will go to preprocessor and compiler. Compiler will transform. So there are like so much of other transformation that is happening. I'm not talking about all of it. This is what we require for the reversing process. So the compiler converts the source code into assembly code. Now you have so many, say for example, you have so many C files when you return the program. Now compiler will convert everything into assembly codes. Now you need to convert assembly code into the binary format, you know, opcode based on the platform that we are targeting. And then it will create so many object files. And then the linker will link all the objects files and the libraries that we have used. For example, the print function using some other library, which is already provided by the operating system. So maybe all this combined together, and finally the executable file is formed. So this is how it building process happens. So you have in a reverse engineering, you have the input as the executable file, and you need to go back and then see how that executable works, how that can disassemble. Okay, so there are some tools other than IDEA that I'm using it today. Ghidra, which is a super good tool. It doesn't only give disassembly, which also decompile the binary, which means disassembly means you'll get the assembly code. If you're decompiling, you'll get a more like, you know, rough C-like language, which is again a little bit difficult, but rather easier than the reading through the assembly code. In IDEA also, there is a decompiling feature available, but you have to pay for it, and you have to pay for the IDEA Pro commercial version also. There are other tools like Binary Ninja and RRI2, which can be used as a disassembler. So let's open the IDEA that we just downloaded. Okay. So now let us drag and drop, or you can open it from there also. For time being, let's drag and drop the executable that we want to disassemble into the IDEA Pro. Okay. Okay, so here, if you see, it automatically detects what type of executable it is. It is an x86 executable. So it automatically detects these features, and then we say, okay, let's disassemble it. So these are some calling conventions that it has to. And then it will start disassemble, and then it will show us the disassembled view of the gatekeeper.exe. If you see in the open PE view, this was how the text looked like. But inside a disassembler, they have disassembled and then gave us the assembly language of that particular executable. So a few things that you have to note here is, whenever there is a disassembly that happens, if the IDEA can itself find out the starting function. Here it is the main function. After the analysis, it will stop at the main function for that we can start. So that we can start from the main function. The analysis can start from the main function. And there are a few windows that you have to get familiarized with. Here, this is the function window. You can search for function names here, control F main. So it will show, you can search by just pressing control F here, and then it will show all those function names which has a main in it. And this graph overview window shows here the overview, where our screen is. So I don't know if you can see, but you know, if you scroll down, there is a small rectangular box which moves about this graph. It's in the trivial only, you don't have to give much importance, but there is another command window here. If you when the binary is getting hectic, it is so large, sometimes it will be difficult for you to go through each line of code and then understand. But IDEA provides a scripting feature wherein you can write scripts in a language which is like native to IDE, which is difficult, but you can also use Python. And then an APIs are provided by a library called IDE Python. You can download and then you can write your own script. For example, if you need to find out all call statements in this function, you can write a script and then run the script, and then it can print all the call statements from this function. So that is how the script functionality in IDE works. And so if you see here, the IDE will automatically tries to analyze the function and then finds out what are the arguments that the function has, what is the coding convention that it used, and it probably can when it finds a function which is at the start, it will assume that this is the first function that the program will execute once the program runs, so it will name it main function. So such capabilities are already there in IDE. So coding, talking about coding convention, so there are different coding conventions. Coding convention defines how a program passes the arguments to the next function, how the stack is being cleaned up and everything. So C declaration coding function, which is like mostly used by C language, pushes all the arguments to the stack before calling a function. So while we debug, we'll get to know this about this more. So once the function, the code function is done executing, it will clean up the stack. We'll talk about cleaning up the stack in later in the session. And there is called STD calling convention. This is again used by Windows APIs. It also passes arguments by pushing all the arguments to the stack. But the cleaning of stack is done by the called function. The function before exiting, it will tries to erase all the local variables that have been assigned to the stack, and then it exits. And there is something called fast called convention, which is like used by x64 binaries in Windows. What is it does? It doesn't use stack before transferring arguments, but it uses the first argument to x, next then to e8, and then to e9. In x64 we don't use ECX, EDX, we use RFCX arguments, because ECX the register is 32 bit in size. If you are using RCX, it is 64 bit in size. So again, okay, Gautam, there is a question. If you need to, you can ask now. Hi, Gautam. Okay. So fast call passes the arguments using registers, but if there are like more than four arguments, if there are arguments more than ECX and ED, more than four in number, the rest of the arguments will be pushed into the stack. So let's we open the file. So this is how a assembly looks like. So before since I have told you the gatekeeper.exe file is a CTF file, so we need to find the username and password for this executable. So play the game along with reverse engineering this product. So let me open a command prompt here. When I run gatekeeper.exe inside the command prompt, it says login information is missing. You need to provide username and password for this function to get the flag. So in capture the flag, that is how it works. You find out something and it will give you back a flag. Flag again is a string, and then you copy it to the portal and then you get the code. So that is how it works. So here for this gatekeeper.exe, you need to find out the username and password. So for that, you need to reverse engineer this gatekeeper.exe. So for that, you need to find out username and password. Okay. So it says the usage of this gatekeeper.exe is it requires two parameters. So let's give some random parameters to it and then see how it behaves. Okay, it says incorrect username. So it accepted the strings that we have given, but it says after verifying that it is incorrect username that I provided. So our task in this reverse engineering challenge is to find out the username and password so that we get the flag. So let's go back to the disassembly and then go through the disassembled code here. So if you see here, always when there is a function starts, there is something called prologue that happens. So prologue means it will set up the stack. So for example, here, if you see push EBP, move EBP ESP. So these are the two instructions that I can here as a prologue, you can see. So what it does is it stores the EBP that was like used by the previous function, which called this main function, will be saved by this push EBP statement. Push EBP, it saves whatever the EBP has to the stack. Now, the main has to have its own stack frame. For that, what it does is like it will create a new stack frame by moving by giving a new base pointer in the EBP. That is done by move ESP EBP. So that does mean that EBP ESP is, as you all know, is pointing towards the top of the stack. It will move the top of the stack to EBP. Now from EBP, we will stack forming the frame, stack frame, start forming the stack frame. And then here, this instruction, add ESP0xFFF0. This is basically for alignment process purpose. So this is again compiler specific. This may or may not be there. It again depends upon the compiler that we are using. And it is not much importance as of now. And next instruction, if you see here, subtract ESP0A0, which means we are allocating some space in the stack for the local variables. Subtracting means we are trying to grow the stack. As I told you, ESP will always grow towards the lower address. You need to subtract. For example, ESP is pointing towards address 10. I need, say, for example, 5 space, space of size 5. So what I'll do, if I need to create a space for 5, I will subtract 5 from ESP, which is pointed towards the 10. So you will get a space of 5. So here I'm making a space of, the executable is making a space of 0x A0. A0 is again in hex format. So if you need to see what A0, which means 160 bytes it's creating for local variables. Okay. Then it's calling another function main. If you go, so in IDE, if you click on the function name, it will go inside the function and then we can see again the disassembly of that particular function. So if you need to go back to the previous function, you have to press escape. If you press escape, you will go back to the previous location. So that is a feature that you need to know. If you double click on the any code statement, it will go to that particular function. So if you see here, it is just an initialization, which you need not worry about. What it does is like, it is checking if the initialized memory has something inside it. If not, it will move a byte into that memory location and then it exits. So it again is compiler specific. So again, after that, if you see the next instruction, so here it is moving something, some offset into ESP. If you see here, the square bracket here, it means it is moving something which is pointed by ESP. That is that square bracket means. So it will move into the stack whatever is pointed by the offset header. So again, if you see the header here, it is the name which has been given by the IDA to an address. So if you double click header, it will go to that particular memory location and it will show what is inside that memory location. It is a string, a slash, and then so many equal to sign. So at this memory location, it has this string. So you again, I press escape and it will go back. So actually what it does is like using this move operation, it is pushing this string to the stack. So this you can think of it as a argument being passed to the function text animation. Next, it will call text animation. So this is how you walk through functions inside a disassembly. So it is a rather hectic thing to do, but you have to sit and do. That is how reverse engineering works. So I will rather go a little fast because I have to show you debugger also. So if you know the template of the main function, there are three arguments that we pass to the main function. One is the count of the arguments that we pass, that will be stored in argc, and the arguments itself pointed by a array of pointers, which is pointed by argv, and then the environment variable. So we are mostly worried about argument v and argument c. So if you see it here, it is checking how many arguments it has. So if you see here argument c, it is comparing 3 with argument c. So it is checking how many arguments we have passed. So if you are coding any function from the command prompt, the argument number will be always 1 irrespective of the arguments that we provide, because the first argument will be the program itself. So it will be always 1. So it is expecting, other than that, it is expecting 2 more arguments. That is what it is showing here. It is comparing whether the arguments are 3 numbers rather. And then if it is not, if there are less than 3 arguments, it will go to. So if you double click on these arrows, you can move up, forward and backward to the function.
Like all the support review.
Sorry? There is some noise in the back.
Yeah, kindly unmute, please.
Okay. So if you double click on the arrows, it will take you to the block where this is being followed. So here, if the compare operation succeeds, it will go to jump 0, means the compare operation succeeded. It will go to the next block, that is denoted by a green line. If it is not succeeded, it will go to another block. So this is how the graph view works. I forgot to mention that, you know, IDE has 2 views. One is graph view, one is the text view. So if you need to view the text view, I forgot the menu, but if you press space bar, it will take you to the text view, wherein you can see a list of instructions. But here the main problem is that you won't be able to see the jump instructions, where it leads and what it is. It will create more confusion. So I will mostly use the graph view so that we know if it doesn't succeed, where it leads to. So here, if it is like less than 3 arguments, what it say, login information missing, you need to, this is the correct usage. So that is what we found here. So if you see it here, it says login information is missing, the usage is gatekeeper.exe, username, password. So thus, that is how that strings got printed. So what we done is like we provided two more arguments so that the argument number became 3, the 2 argument number plus the name of the program 3, and then it went to this. So in the next, see, if you see the command prompt, it printed verifying. So that is how this verifying got printed here. And then if you go down, you can see a string compare function here. String compare function compares 2 strings. So you need to see what those 2 strings are. Here, if you see here, it is comparing something in EAX. If you go back, so it is taking something from argument V. Argument V, as I told, it is again the argument that this function received, and it points to the arguments that we provided. So it is copying that argument to EAX. So the EAX will be pointing towards the first argument. We have to move towards the second argument. That is why they have added 4 here. And it is taking out whatever is in EAX. And then it is in this instruction, if you see, move ESP EAX, it is pushing that argument into the stack. And also, if you see here, the instruction above it, it is again moving whatever is in offset. So whatever is in offset, so the idea has already derived, took the strings from there and it has printed out in the graph view for you. So it is one warming, you know, in a neat language. So it is pushing this string into the stack, and then it is taking the first, second, it's the first argument that we provided from the RV parameter and then pushing it into the stack, and then it is calling str compare function. So that is how you disassemble. So you don't know how the memory works. You are assuming things and then you are going on. So for that, so to ease up the process, you can use debugger. Debugger has its own disadvantage because you may not be able to see the assembly code in such a pretty way. So so let me see if I have done everything. Epilogue. I'll talk about epilogue and commenting and renaming. Okay, let's move into debugging part. So let me open WinDBG, the debugger. So I have a WinDBG preview with me. If you don't have preview, you can open normal WinDBG also. And let me open, let me launch the executable. Okay, so you, when you are launching executable in WinDBG, now you understood that you have to provide two arguments to the function, to the program. So you have to go to launch executable advanced, so that you provide two arguments here. So the executable path has to be, you have to go to the executable path and then give the executable here. And then you have to provide two arguments, because you know that anyway it is going to fail because you are not providing any arguments. You are providing two arguments here. So let me provide two arguments, ASDF space, the second argument ASDF. And let's run the program. So what I'm doing is, like, I'm running the program inside a debugger. So how debugger works, it's again a big topic, but the time is like so less for us. We'll not delve into it. So the debugger breaks just before the function executes. So if you breaks in the sense it stops, it pauses the program and then give the control back to us, the user, so that we can do manipulate the program. So if you press, so this WinDBG is rather a command oriented. There are other debuggers like single debugger, only debug and everything, which is like much more user interactive. But I have been using WinDBG for such a long time, and it is a very powerful tool if you are debugging WinDBG Windows, that is why. So let's see what all are the modules loaded inside when you started executing the program. So for that, there is a command called lm. If you press lm, you can see what all are the modules loaded. For example, gatekeeper is the exe file that you just loaded into the memory. And these are all of the libraries. I told you there are some functionalities you need not write inside your program, but you can import it from the other libraries. So these are all the libraries that loaded that the gatekeeper loaded, and it will import the functions like printf from msvcrt and kernel32 will give more kernel communications, means OS based communication, APIs and all. So here gatekeeper is loaded, and it is loaded at the memory address 40000. So when you are executing a binary, so the compiler will make sure that, you know, it will give an address to the binary saying that this binary has to be loaded at a particular address. So I should have shown it in the PE view, but for this binary, it says that it has loaded in 0x40000. So, because of this static address, it created some security problems for Windows. So they introduced something called ASLR, address space random layout randomization, wherein even if you ask the binary to load at this particular location, it will load at different locations at different times. So, it is like a more advanced topic, but you don't have to worry about that. For now, the gatekeeper has been loaded at gatekeeper.exe. So now I need to, I'm going to run the program gatekeeper.exe, and then I need to break the program. Break the program in the sense I need to, the program will keep on executing, and then I need to stop, pause the program at this main function. So let me go and then find out what address the main program is located. So if you press space bar, it will show the address of that particular instruction. So if you press the address of that particular location is 401640. So 40 is the base of this executable, and then 1640 is the offset to this particular main function. So let me copy that address and then put a breakpoint. For putting a breakpoint, the command is bp and then the address. So I have put a breakpoint. So if you need to see the breakpoint list, the breakpoints that we have put, the command is bl. And if you press bl, you can see the breakpoints that we have just inserted. Now you have a breakpoint at the main function. You can run the program. Go. So if you press here, it executes the program and then it will break. It will pause at the breakpoint that we have just set. So that is at the main function. So if you go back and see the same, you can see the same instructions in the debugger. So let me configure my debugger such that you can see the stack. So this is the memory window. You can go here and then take any. So here the memory window is there. So if you press, the memory window will appear. So if you need to see the top of the stack, you can enter here the address which you want to look at. So since I want to always see the top of the stack, let me put ESP. So this point towards the top of the stack, and then there is a register window here. If you open up here, you can see all the registers that it is going to. So EAX, EBX, ECX, and EDX, and EBP and ESP. So ESP is pointing towards address EDC. That is what we are seeing here. The address EDC, the memory contents of the EDC, we can look here. And the EBP is pointing towards the base of the stack. So it is FF68, which is somewhere deep below. So it's come somewhere here. Yes, okay. Now, I just want to show you how the prolog works. If you push, you can see the instruction here. This is the instruction that the EIP is pointing towards. If I step through the instruction here, first stepping, if you go to home, there are like different controls for us. I'm going to use step over because we are stepping through the instruction. If I just click once, it will execute this instruction, push EBP, ESP. No, push EBP. So what is inside EBP for our reference? EBP contains something, FF68. So, and we are looking at the top of the stack. And then if you press step over, that address has been pushed to the stack. And if you see, the stack pointer has been changed. It was earlier pointing towards DC. Now the ESP's value has been moved to D8. That is how the push operation happens. And move EBP, ESP, now the EBP, now we have to change the EBP to point towards the new stack frame. We'll step once again, and you can see how EBP and ESP changes. Step over. So now EBP and ESP points towards the same location, which is where the ESP is going to. So that is how you step through the debugger and then see. So for the sake of the simplicity and for less time, let's go to this string compare function and then put a breakpoint there and then see what happens there. So the address for that string compare instruction is 165C. I just copied it. I'm putting a breakpoint here and then I'm running the program. So if you press F5, it is equivalent to playing the program. Go. So it will take some time since. So it has been, it is paused at the str compare function. Now, so before, if you see the IDA, you can see both string, the string that it took from the offset, the string that we provided has been pushed into the stack. So let's see the contents of the stack. So if you see here, the content of the stack is like, for dumping any content of the stack. So if you see here stack, it has two memory locations. So let me take the first memory location and a command called dump ASCII, because it is pointing towards a string. We are using dump ASCII command. And then if you press the if you give the memory address, if you press, it is pointing towards ASDF, which is exactly what argument that we have provided. And let me see what the other memory address pointing to. Dump ASCII, the other pointing address, it is pointing towards 11, which is the string that it has taken from the executable itself. So it is comparing ASDF with 11, and then let's see what result. So if the comparison succeeds, the EAX will be having zero. Otherwise, the EAX will point towards a negative number. So let's see. I'm just stepping over, and then let's see what EAX contains. So EAX contains one. I'm sorry, it contains one. So that does mean that, you know, if it was equal, it would have given us zero, but it is different, it is showing us one. So it has failed. Now it will exit the program. So if you see, if you jump, let's see jump where jump equals runs to. We should have so if it succeeds, it should have come here. If it fails, it would have it goes here. So let's see where it goes to. It goes to the same instruction, it goes to move. So it fails again, it is going to print access denied, incorrect username, it's going to print. So that is how you see the memory and the debug the program. So let me restart the program again with some different with the arguments that we just found out from during this phase, during the disassembly phase, which is 1 hour. Let's copy it and paste and provide it as the argument. And then now let's put a breakpoint at this location at the compare function. For that, I'm copying the address. I'm putting a breakpoint here. And again, running the program. So let's see what the ESP and the parameters are. For the dump ASCII, the first argument, it's 11, and the second argument, dump ASCII, it's again 11. So if I step through the str compare function, let's see what EAX would contain. Step over. Now, if you see open the registers, it contains zero. That does mean that, you know, the string compare function succeeded. So let's see where it moves to. Jump equals. So if you go here, if it succeeds, it moves to EAX, and it is trying to get the next argument. So here you can see, it is move EAX, it is trying to get the next argument, EBP 0C, because WinDBG doesn't know how it is the next argument, it uses memory address. That is why it says 0C, otherwise it is argument B. So that is how you debug the process. Since time is less here, it is close to 11:30, and I should leave some space for question answers. I leave it here. So the same way, what you can do is, like, you can this be taken up as an assignment. What you can do is you can go to the next string compare function happens here. And you can put a breakpoint there, and then you can compare what the stack pointed towards. It will be pointing, one string would be from the offset, this, and the other string would be the argument that we provide. So why don't you you can take up this string and copy and put it as the second argument, and then you can break at the string compare function, and then you can see if the string compare function is matching this argument with the argument that we provided, or it has done some transformation over it. And then so if you find out the correct argument, it is not for simplicity as a hint, I'm telling, it is not this argument. They will do some modification on this string, and then it will be used as another string for the comparison. So you need to find out what that modification is all about, and you can take this up an assignment, and you can get back to me offline if you have any doubts. So that is how you debug a binary, and that is how you disassemble using debugger and disassemblers. So I have shown you all those things. So, if you take up reverse engineering as a hobby or as you are developing your reverse engineering skills, you can use it in malware researchers because since we are in the industries, I find a little bit of shortage for people like malware researchers or vulnerability researchers. It is not just understanding how this tool works, but you have to keep on practicing and practicing. That is how you can develop this skill. If you apply for jobs, it is easy for you to get. Somebody asked for the write-up for the CTF. You can simply search gatekeeper CTF write-up. It is available in the public. So many people have written a write-up for this. Still, you have doubts, you can come back to me anytime. Other than that, I need to talk about bug bounties, because you know Microsoft has a bug bounty program where they ask researchers out there to reverse engineer their product. For example, the biggest bug bounty provided by the Microsoft is $150,000, which is like enormous, and people have already gained it. What they have to do is like you have to reverse engineer a product called Hyper-V, which is like the virtualization software for the Microsoft. And you have to find out bugs and report it. And people have already reported bugs and then received the money. So it's huge. A bug bounties are huge. So there are people following bug bounties as their career. They are not doing anything, just the bug bounties. So that's also a career option. And if you see recent McAfee researchers' blogs, whose links are provided below, they have done fantastic work on reverse engineering. So there is a team called ATR, Advanced Threat Research in McAfee, which do advanced threat analysis of the recent malware and everything. So this, the other companies' approach to do vulnerability analysis on their system. So they reverse engineer their product and then find out the vulnerabilities of their product. So one such product was iParcel Box. So if you go to the link, they'll give you a bit more information. So also there is one more blog which talks about a protocol that used in the WSL. WSL again is a feature that Windows provide to run Linux executables. So it is like they are embracing Linux architecture inside Windows. So they analyze the Windows protocol and find out the bug inside the protocol itself. So these are some of the few ransomware that the team has reverse engineered and then provided protection and let the world know how this can work. So that is about the career opportunities. So when I talked about the reverse engineering, I told you the first two links are extremely good. If you are thinking of taking up reverse engineering parallel analysis as a career, the first one, opensecuritytraining.info, is a free portal wherein it gives all the resources required for you to learn reverse engineering. It talks about binary file format, it talks about basics of assembly language, it talks about many other stuff. So if you go and visit this portal, it gives so much of information. It is very invaluable for people who are opting for a career in cybersecurity. And next blog talks about it is actually a good course to look after if you are looking for reverse engineering. It leads you to step by step process of how to reverse engineer a binary in Windows. So that is about it.
Sure.
Go. Hello. You can ask me, I can hear you. Okay. So if you have any doubts, you can write a mail to bosco@gmail.com. Or bosco_sebastian@mcafee.com.
Hello?
Yes, go on.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Some problem.
We can hear you.
Hello?
Please go ahead. Yeah, we can hear you. Can you type if suppose I think we are not able to.
So once again, thank you. Thanks a lot for taking this session. It was a wonderful session. Participants also enjoyed. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I need to thank Jayadhar sir also because he was my guy. He was my professor.
Sorry, we are unable to hear you.
Okay.